So a few weeks ago, we were all introduced to NVIDIA's first non-RTX GPU for 2019, the GTX 1660 Ti. I said that right this time, by the way. Now, even though this thing can't run AI or ray tracing operations, it still offers some great value for gamers who don't see a point in paying a premium for the features that aren't just being used yet. So that brings us to today's review, which was almost late because of UPS. Damn it, I hate UPS. I just really do. But anyways, it's finally here. This, my friends, is the GTX 1660. Non-TI, that is. And its starting price is at $220, which is pretty affordable if you think about it, considering the GTX 1060 was launched at around $250, and the older GTX 960 was launched at $200 since its release day. It's also interesting to note that NVIDIA's GTX 1060 and cards around this price point are the most popular right now on Steam's hardware survey. So this is a very important launch. So why don't we get into the review, but first, a quick message from our sponsor. The new Enermax LickTech TR4 AIO Liquid CPU Cooler now features this beautifully diffused RGB lighting around the CPU block that can be customized via this control box or through your motherboard. It covers 100% of the IHS, plus it comes in 240, 280, and 360mm variants. Learn more in the description down below. Now before I get into the benchmarks, let's actually get into what the GTX 1660 is. But at the same time, if you just want to skip directly into performance, I'll actually leave timestamps down in the comments. Also, if you want to check out our GTX 1660 Ti review and learn a little bit more about the architecture, you can actually check that up right over here. Like I said in the GTX 1660 Ti video, these new GTX cards use the 12-nanometer TU116 core, which incorporates all of the Turing architecture's improvements except the RT and tensor units. That means RTX has been crossed off the spec sheet, but performance in standard games gets a big boost. NVIDIA did this because AI and ray tracing operations need to be backed up by a huge amount of rendering power, and that's something these lower priced options just don't have. So if you want RTX, you'll need to spend a little bit more money and buy an RTX 2060 or a higher end GPU. The GTX 1660 specs are pretty interesting too. It uses a cut down version of the GTX 1660 Ti's core with a little over 1400 CUDA cores and slightly higher clock speeds, while the TDP remains at 120 watts. The real difference here is with memory. The 1660 still has 6 GB and 192-bit wide interface, but it uses GDDR5 modules operating at 8 GHz instead of 12 GHz of GDDR6. While that could cause memory bandwidth bottlenecks in some games, I wouldn't be surprised if a bit of overclocking brings a stock GTX 1660 close to a GTX 1660 Ti. Unfortunately, due to some other shipping issues, I wasn't able to get a stock GTX 1660 in time for this video, but EVGA ended up sending their XC Ultra version. Personally, I have mixed feelings about this card in terms of design, but it's a lot better than the triple slot version that I looked at in our GTX 1660 Ti video. Even though the length is about 10.5 inches or 268 millimeters, it'll fit into more small form factor cases too. Other than that, turning the card over shows that EVGA has used a shorter PCB and then attached a massive cooler. The overhang is protected by a small backplate, but the design also means the power connector gets popped into an interesting location. The rear I/O area is pretty straightforward with single outputs for DVI, HDMI, and DisplayPort. It's nice to see DVI here since a lot of gamers looking for more affordable cards might not have a newer monitor, and the last thing anyone wants to buy is another adapter. The XC Ultra version has also been pre-overclocked by EVGA, and its core runs about 60 MHz higher than the stock version. That likely won't result in all that much performance, especially since the memory sticks to 8 GHz. The price is what might trip a few people up, since this card will hit $250, but EVGA will be offering a limited $10 rebate at launch, bringing it to $240. One thing I did notice during testing was that the boost clock constantly sat at 1965 MHz. That's almost 100 MHz higher than what our reference spec 1660 Ti hit. So let's cut this short right here and get right onto the benchmarks. As we run through these charts, you'll basically see the same thing repeated over and over again. The GTX 1660 outperforms the GTX 1060 by a pretty big margin at both resolutions, sometimes by over 25%. But does that mean that you should be replacing the 1060 if you have one? Absolutely not. But if you have a GTX 960 or an earlier GPU, this will be a huge step up at a price that's really close to what you paid a few years ago. Another thing that's important to mention again is the EVGA card I'm using over here is pre-overclocked, but not by a huge amount. I'm gonna say that the increased clock speeds add between 2-3% at most to the scores versus a stock 1660. Now, when you compare it to the 1660 Ti, performance is really variable. At times, they're pretty close with this new card. In some other times, it even comes close to the GTX 1070 performance levels, but frame rates really aren't consistent across every title. In a few games, the non-Ti models falls way too behind, but that actually happens a lot more often at 1440p, so the gap is likely due to the 1660's lower memory clock speeds. You can actually see that situation pretty clearly in Hellblade, Rainbow Six, and Witcher at 1080p. Then again, at 1440p, games like Far Cry 5, Battlefield, and even Overwatch can be added to that list too, particularly with the lower 1% of frame times. Against AMD cards, the GTX 1660 is roughly equal to a performance of an RX 590, but that card almost consumes a ton more power and even costs a bit more right now. I wouldn't be surprised if AMD further lowers prices on the RX 580 and RX 590. Quickly moving on to power consumption, this pre-overclocked EVGA GTX 1660 XE Ultra actually consumes a bit less than the GTX 1060 superclocked. And that just goes to show you how much NVIDIA's new architecture and the 12 nanometer manufacturing process are able to improve performance per watt. So I guess it's time to wrap things up, and I have to say, I'm pretty impressed with NVIDIA's new GTX series cards. Even though almost every one of the RTX cards felt overpriced, the GTX 1660 Ti and now the GTX 1660 really do feel like good values for their price points. I wouldn't run out to replace a 10 series card with them, but if you're coming from an older generation GPU, they could be an awesome choice. However, I can say that the 1660 is perfect. If you look at the XE Ultra from EVGA in this case, it's a $30 premium over the stock GPU, and that almost gets closer to what you would pay for a reference spec GTX 1660 Ti. Also, the GDDR5 memory modules may cause some bottlenecks in some situations, but from an overall perspective, I think this is a pretty solid choice for the price. So that pretty much wraps this up, guys. Let me know what you guys think about the GTX 1660. If you're rocking a GTX 960 or perhaps a 760, would this be an upgrade in the pipeline for you guys? Let me know in the comments down below. I'm Ibar with hardwarecanucks. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out some relevant content over here. Subscribe to our boot sequence channel. I'm signing off, and I'll see you guys in the next one.